Given the high technical sophistication of today's aircraft, it's sometimes difficult to believe that powered flight has been in existence for less than a century. This is especially when viewing planes like the Lockheed F-117A Nighthawk, whose unique profile makes it appear like something out of science fiction. Yet those who fly the Nighthawk are a little different in character to the pioneers of aviation. It's merely the machines themselves that have changed. Even so, few who were alive in 1900 would have believed that flight could have progressed as far as it has during the century. Speed, altitude, maneuverability, and endurance have all increased dramatically. Furthermore, within 60 years of the first powered flight, humanity was reaching out into space and would realize the age-old dream of landing human beings on the moon. But again, the astronauts who orbit our planet demonstrate the same adaptability to the strange environment that is space as the early aviators displayed when they first left the ground. Nevertheless, the realization of humanity's urge to fly and the development of aviation to the level that it has reached today is truly one of the great achievements of the 20th century. The achievement is all the greater for the fact that the dream of flying has existed almost since human beings first evolved on this planet. One of the best-loved Greek myths is that of Daedalus and his son Icarus, who made wings of wax so as to escape from the cruel king Minos of Crete. Daedalus succeeded, but Icarus flew too close to the sun, which melted the wax, and he plunged into the sea to his death. Most of the early thought on flight was indeed based on that of the birds and analysis of the way in which they operate their wings. The famous 16th century Italian scientist and artist Leonardo da Vinci devoted much study to the problem and designed, at least on paper, flapping wing flying machines. He concluded that
a bird is an instrument working according to mathematical law, which instrument it is within the capacity of man to reproduce with all its movements, but not with a corresponding degree of strength, though it is deficient only in the power of maintaining equilibrium.
For almost the next 300 years, people tried to build successful ornithopters, as flying machines based on the operation of birds' wings became called, but with no success. Da Vinci was therefore right in his belief that given the scientific knowledge of the day, humans could not on their own develop the necessary power to remain airborne. But another, entirely different approach to flight was pursued in the late 18th century. French brothers Joseph and Étienne Montgolfier observed that the heat of a fire propels charred paper upwards. Using a brazier to provide the heated air, they successfully launched a paper-lined linen balloon at the end of April 1783. It flew to a height of 1,000 feet and landed 3/4 of a mile away. Seven months later, on the 21st of November, 1783, the first Montgolfier balloon capable of carrying passengers took off from the grounds of a royal castle in Paris. In the basket, below, was Pilate de Rozier, who was accompanied by the Marquis d'Allende. As the balloon rose into the air, d'Allende recalled,
"I was surprised at the silence and the absence of movement which our departure caused among the spectators, and believed them to be astonished and perhaps awed at the strange spectacle. They might well have reassured themselves. I was still gazing when Monsieur Rozier cried to me, 'You are doing nothing, and the balloon is scarcely rising a fathom.' 'Pardon me,' I answered, as I placed a bundle of straw upon the fire and slightly stirred it."
The first men to fly were airborne for 25 minutes. They landed 5 miles from their takeoff point, having experienced sensations that were at that time unique. Ballooning rapidly became popular as a sport. It remains so to this day, but the balloonist is largely dependent on the direction of the wind, and hence is not complete master of his or her own destiny. Thus, for total control, a power source which could override the elements was needed. Frenchman Henri Giffard designed an airship powered by a steam engine and flew it a distance of 17 miles in September 1852. He used a cloth rudder to steer the craft. But the heavier-than-air flying machine was also being pursued. Most designers still believe that an aircraft would have to be based on the flapping wing principle. Among them was the German Otto Lilienthal. But he was unique for his time in recognizing that before launching such a machine off the ground, it was vital to learn how to fly it. Consequently, during the early 1890s, Lilienthal built a series of gliders, flying them from a hill outside Berlin. He learned to control them by shifting his body weight, just as a hang glider pilot does, and soon forsook the flapping for the fixed wing. Sadly, Lilienthal was killed in August 1896, when one of his gliders stalled and crashed. Two American brothers, Orville and Wilbur Wright, had become aviation enthusiasts and studied Lilienthal's flight data. They ran a bicycle business in Dayton, Ohio, and had a good grounding in engineering. In 1899, they used their knowledge to build a glider. Beginning where Lilienthal left off, they made a series of experimental flights in sand dunes at Kitty Hawk, North Carolina. But now came dramatic advances in lighter-than-air machines. These were principally spurred by the development of the internal combustion engine, which was already successfully powering motor cars. German aristocrat Count Ferdinand von Zeppelin had long been interested in airships and began to design one in 1893.
My own airship consists of a strong and completely enclosed chamber with numerous partitions. In the compartments formed thereby, folded envelopes shaped to the compartments are first inserted and then filled with gas. These gas containers, which are able to raise the whole weight of the machine, thus escape all pressure due to the movement through the air.
The gas used in Zeppelin's airships was hydrogen, and the early ones were powered by two 15-horsepower Daimler engines, one attached to each of the two gondolas suspended underneath. From 1900 onwards, Zeppelins, as they became known, became an increasingly common sight in Germany. But others, too, were pursuing airships. Brazilian Alberto Santos Dumont was the son of a wealthy coffee planter. He'd been inspired to build airships by the sight of gas balloons over Paris during his first visit to Europe in 1891. 10 years later, Santos Dumont astounded the whole of France and became a national hero with his Numero 6 airship, although its engines were less powerful than the early Zeppelins. At stake was a prize of 100,000 gold francs, and Santos Dumont won it by flying round Paris's most famous landmark, the Eiffel Tower. Although no relation, in spite of his appearance, to Wild West showman Buffalo Bill Cody, Texan Colonel Samuel Cody was pursuing a different course in Britain. He experimented with man-lifting kites, in which the British Army showed an interest as observation platforms. Meanwhile, research into heavier-than-air flight had been growing. In 1902, after many attempts, Orville and Wilbur Wright developed a glider which they could actually control in the air. This involved maneuvering the glider about three axes: horizontal for pitch, longitudinal for roll, and vertical for yaw. The next step was to build an engine for it. The task was given to the Wrights' mechanic at the cycle shop, Charlie Taylor, who in old age recalled,
"I made all the different parts in the motor. I even made the crankshaft. So I made it out of a solid block of steel, about 32 inches long, 6 inches wide, and inch and 5/8 thick. Cut it right out of the solid block by drilling holes and knocking out large pieces out of it, and then turning it up in the lathe. The motor itself, from the time I started, I had it ready for test, was 6 weeks.
By mid-November 1903, the engine was ready, and Orville and Wilbur then took it and the glider by train to Kitty Hawk. Here they assembled the complete aircraft and then waited for favorable weather. The controls included bicycle parts, and two propellers would be driven by the engine. On the 17th of December, the weather conditions finally promised sufficient wind. It was Orville Wright's turn to pilot the Flyer, as they named their machine. Then came the often reconstructed moment of truth, as helpers maneuvered the Wright Flyer into position. At 10:35 a.m., Orville started the engine and prepared to launch himself into the unknown. He later reported,
"Into the teeth of a December gale, the Flyer made its way forward with a speed of 10 miles an hour over the ground and 30 to 35 miles an hour through the air. The height chosen was scarcely sufficient for maneuvering in so gusty a wind, and with no previous acquaintance with the conduct of the machine, and its controlling mechanisms. Consequently, the first flight was short.
It covered just 120 feet and lasted a mere 12 seconds. But they made a further three flights that morning, with Wilbur flying for nearly a minute during the last, before a gust of wind turned the flyer over and damaged it. Now they released the news of their success to the world. Back in Dayton, Ohio, was the Wrights' housekeeper, Terry Grumbach.
I remember the telegram when it came, that they had flown, that they had done what they said they would do. They always did as they had planned.
But what was truly remarkable was the Wright brothers' ability to control the flyer. Pitch was achieved through the elevators at the front of the aircraft and operated by a lever. An ingenious system of warping the ends of the wings provided roll, and the rudders enabled yaw. For both, the prone pilot lay in a cradle, leaning his body to warp the wings and using his hips to operate the cables to the rudders. But the Wright flyer could not achieve flying speed under its own power on takeoff. The Wrights had therefore devised a wooden takeoff rail on which the aircraft was placed. A cable was then run from the machine to a large weight suspended in a makeshift tower. The engine was then started. At a signal from the pilot, the weight was released and the flyer propelled along the rail and into the air. The brothers continued to perfect the aircraft, and in October 1905, Wilbur achieved a flight of 38 minutes in Flyer 3. But experts still found it hard to believe that the Wright brothers had achieved controlled flight. Nowhere was this more so than in France, where the first powered heavier-than-air flight had not taken place until towards the end of 1906. Once again, it was the redoubtable Alberto Santos Dumont who achieved this in his ungainly numero 14 bis, number 14 twice. He flew just under 200 feet in a straight line at a height of 10 feet above the ground. In his wake, other French aircraft designers made their maiden flights. Names like the brothers Gabriel and Charles Voisin, who helped Santos Dumont build his 14 bis, and Louis Blériot, joined Santos Dumont in the hall of French and indeed European heroes of the day. For flying had become one of, if not the, greatest excitement of the decade, as an increasing number of daring young men took to the air. It was at this time that the rotary wing aircraft also took its first ungainly steps into the air. French bicycle maker Paul Cornu's helicopter was the first to fly, albeit for a few brief seconds, in November 1907. But it was still the lighter-than-air airship which appeared to show the most potential, especially those of Count von Zeppelin. Zeppelin's airships were growing in size and sophistication. It was particularly their endurance which was notable. By 1909, Zeppelins could remain aloft for well over 24 hours at a time. In contrast, flights by heavier-than-air machines were still being measured in minutes. The endurance being achieved by the airships inspired one man to try the seemingly impossible. In 1907, American journalist Walter Wellman attempted without success to fly over the North Pole in his airship America. 3 years later, he set off across the Atlantic, but bad weather caused America to drift out of control. After 2 days, the crew were forced to abandon it. They were rescued, leaving the airship to fly off on its own. As far as heavier-than-air machines were concerned, the debate continued to rage in Europe over the degree of control that the Wright brothers had over their aircraft. For, try as they might, the European designers were still unable to achieve little more than flight in a straight line. Accordingly, they invited Wilbur Wright, who happened to be in Europe at the time, to demonstrate the flyer's maneuverability. They themselves remained skeptical and believed that the solution to controlled flight still had to be found. On the afternoon of Saturday, the 8th of August, 1908, Wilbur Wright prepared to make his demonstration flight in front of a French audience at Le Mans racetrack in northern France. When all was ready, Wilbur took off. He flew a circular course. Although the flight lasted only 105 seconds, it was a tumultuous success. As a French journalist reported,
"The facility with which the machine flies and the dexterity with which the aviator gave proof from the first in his maneuvering have completely dissipated all doubts." Not one of the detractors of the Wrights dare question today the previous experiments of the men who were truly the first to fly.
Back in America, Orville Wright had not been idle, as U.S. military aviation pioneer Frank Lahm later described.
After 4 long years of failing to recognize the Wrights, finally in December of 1907, the Board of Ordnance and Fortifications granted the interview to Wilbur. At once, he inspired their confidence. This led to a contract in February of 1908 between the Wright brothers and the Signal Corps, in which they agreed to furnish an airplane that would fly 40 miles an hour, carry 2 persons, remain in the air for 1 hour, and, strange to relate, was to have some kind of a device by which, in case the motor stopped, it could be landed without crashing. In the summer of 1908, Orville Wright brought to Fort Myer, Virginia, the airplane that was to fulfill the specifications of the contract. Day after day, we watched him fly around and around the field in his tuning-up flights. And finally, on the 9th of September, he broke the world record by staying in the air for over 1 hour. On landing, he came to me and said, "Would you like to go up?" You can guess my answer. And I made my first flight in an airplane that day with Orville Wright, 6 minutes and 40 seconds.
Frank Lahm was the very first soldier to fly in an aircraft, and his flight marks the beginning of fixed-wing military aviation. In October 1909, Frank Lahm of the U.S. Army Signal Corps was taught to fly by the Wrights, and became one of the first 2 pilots in the U.S. Army's Air Service, the ancestor of today's U.S. Air Force. Flying schools were now beginning to spring up both in America and continental Europe for civilian enthusiasts as well. In contrast, the first powered flight in Britain was not made until October 1908. And this was thanks to larger-than-life Texan Colonel Samuel Cody of man-lifting kite fame. He built his aeroplane number one, which was similar in shape to the Wright Flyer for the British War Office, which had finally become interested in aviation. Sadly, Cody was to be killed 5 years later when an aircraft he was testing broke up in the air. The wreckage fell in a group of trees near Farnborough, southwest of London. Today, the home of the major international air show, which is held every 2 years. Cody's accident illustrated only too clearly that the slow speed and flimsy structure of these early aircraft made them very vulnerable, especially to sudden gusts of wind. Consequently, pilot fatalities were not infrequent. But in the eyes of the public, this merely added to the glamour of aviation. The British Bristol box kite of 1910 is typical of the aircraft of the first decade of powered flight. It was also one of the first aircraft to use ailerons, flaps on the edges of the wings, instead of wing warping, to control roll. Such was the general public's growing fascination with flight that by 1910, air shows were being staged on both sides of the Atlantic. In August 1909, some 500,000 people attended the opening day of what was billed as the first international air show, which was held at Reims in France. During the week, the spectators were privileged to see most of the leading aviators of the day taking part in various flying contests. The most prestigious competition was for a magnificent silver trophy. This was presented by James Gordon Bennett, multimillionaire publisher of the New York Herald and a keen supporter of land, sea, and air speed. The contestants had to complete two laps of a circuit just over 6 miles long, the fastest aircraft being the winner. A French team with a Blériot monoplane, Wright biplane, and Antoinette monoplane competed with a British Farman and an American flown aircraft. American Glenn Curtis was the winner, flying his Reims Racer around the course at an average speed of 47 miles per hour. Second was Frenchman Louis Blériot, who had gained immortal aviation fame just 1 month earlier. The London Daily Mail had offered a prize of £1,000 for the first aircraft crossing of the English Channel. The first to try was Briton Hubert Latham in a French Antoinette monoplane. He made his attempt from Cap Grinet, the closest point on the French coast to England, on the 19th of July, 1909. A crowd of well-wishers was there to see his departure. Latham took off just after 5:45 in the morning. He seemed to be going well, but 7 miles out over the English Channel, Latham's engine stopped and he was forced to ditch in the sea. Luckily, the large wing area of the Antoinette kept it afloat until Latham could be rescued. The plane itself was recovered and repaired in time for Latham to try again 8 days later. He would once more be forced to ditch, this time just 500 yards from his goal. In the meantime, on the 25th of July, 1909, Louis Blériot had made his attempt.
A light breeze from the southwest was blowing. The air was clear. Everything was prepared. I was dressed as I am at this moment, a khaki jacket lined with wool for warmth over my tweed clothes. My close-fitting cap was fastened over my head and ears. I had neither eaten nor drunk anything since I rose. My thoughts were only upon the flight and my determination to accomplish it this morning.
Blériot had taken off at 4:35 a.m. and was soon flying over the water at a speed of some 45 miles per hour and altitude of 300 feet. Like Hubert Latham, Blériot's target was the port of Dover. The distance across the channel here is some 23 miles. From his takeoff point at Sangatte, Blériot headed directly towards Dover. But after a while, the wind began to blow him northwards. He therefore turned southwest and followed three ships making for the port. 37 minutes after setting out, Blériot landed in a field on the outskirts of Dover. In spite of the early hour, a sizable crowd soon gathered to congratulate him on his magnificent achievement. A French warship then took Blériot and his aircraft back across the channel to his homeland. Blériot was now taken to Paris. Here he was feted on a scale seldom equaled at the time. Blériot's Type 11 monoplane, with its 24 horsepower and Zani engine and 29-foot wingspan, had opened up the promise of ever longer flights. Speed and distance had now become the prime objectives for designers of heavier-than-air aircraft. By 1910, aircraft had evolved into two basic types. One was the pusher with the engine mounted behind the pilot, as in the Bristol box kite. The other type had the engine in the front and was known as a tractor, since the propeller dragged rather than pushed the aircraft through the air. Aircraft controls were becoming simpler. Many now had a joystick, which moved backwards and forwards to control pitch and sideways for roll. pilot had a foot bar to operate the rudders and used his left hand to control the engine throttle. He couldn't let his concentration lapse for one moment and had at all times to be sensitive to the effects of wind on his machine. Other aircraft, like the 1910 Avro triplane, used a combined control wheel and joystick. The stick operated the elevators and rudders. The wheel was used to warp the wings for roll. British designer A.V. Rowe had given this machine an additional third wing to provide greater lift, although this did increase drag. Lighter-than-air vehicles were also continuing to develop. In 1910, a firm called Delag began to operate passenger-carrying Zeppelins on flights between German cities, making it the first commercial airline in the world. By the outbreak of the Great War in August 1914, the Zeppelins had carried a total of 35,000 passengers without a single death or injury. At this stage, the airship seemed the most likely competitor to ocean liners for long-distance travel. Elsewhere, flight remained essentially a spectacle. The more maneuverable the aircraft, the more the crowds flocked to the air shows to gasp in wonderment and delight. Flyers themselves were regarded like the football heroes of today. At an air show held at St. Louis, Missouri, in October 1910, there was an added attraction for the spectators. No less a person than colorful former President of the United States, Teddy Roosevelt, attended. Not only this, but he decided to try flying for himself and was taken up as a passenger in a Wright biplane. The flight was just a few minutes long. Roosevelt expressed himself thrilled by the experience. The crowd roared their appreciation as Roosevelt's cavalcade left the showground. Aircraft performance continued to improve. The annual Gordon Bennett Trophy contest saw speed climb rapidly. Frenchman Jules Vedrine won the 1912 competition, which took place at Chicago, Illinois. His remarkably modern-looking Depardieu-Saint monoplane, with its 150-horsepower engine, flew the 125-mile course at 105 miles per hour. But Marcel Prévost, who came second, got his own back the following year at Reims in France. Flying another Depardieu-Saint, he achieved just under 125 miles per hour. Given that the Wright brothers' first flights only 10 years earlier had been flown at a mere 30 miles per hour, this dramatic increase in speed showed how quickly the aircraft was developing. With every year that passed, aircraft were also flying further. In April 1909, in Britain, two pilots competed to be the first to fly from London to Manchester, a distance of 185 miles, in 24 hours, with two stops allowed. Briton Claude Graham White took off first, but was driven down by engine problems and high winds. These actually turned his parked aircraft over, necessitating a return to London for repairs. Rival Frenchman Louis Paulin now joined Graham White, who made a second attempt, only to be foiled once more by the wind. Paulin himself took off before Graham White, with a special railway train acting as a guide. He made one landing and reached Manchester in 11 hours to claim the prize put up by the London Daily Mail. In July 1911, a race was held over a circuit covering nearly 1,000 miles, from Paris, France, to Liège in Belgium, Utrecht in the Netherlands, Brussels, Rouen and Calais in France, and then across the English Channel to London, before finally finishing in Paris. No fewer than 52 aircraft took part in the race. The winning pilot, André Beaumont, completed the course in just 58 hours and 38 minutes. '11 also witnessed the first flight across the United States. However, it took pilot Calbraith Rogers 49 days in his Wright aircraft, and his 69 stops included no less than 16 crash landings. But the most impressive flight of the early years of flying was by a Morane Saulnier monoplane in September 1913. Its pilot was Frenchman Roland Garros, one of the leading aviators of the day. His aim was to fly the Mediterranean non-stop from the French Riviera to Tunisia. This 470-mile flight from Cannes to Bizerta took him just under 8 hours to complete. What was even more remarkable about this flight was that Garros used a land plane instead of a seaplane, which would have been very much safer. Seaplanes were now almost as common as land planes and had followed the same course of development, with gliders being used first to test the concept. Jacques Schneider, heir to a large French steel and armaments empire, established the seaplane equivalent to the Gordon Bennett trophy. His own trophy depicted an angel embracing a mermaid. The first Schneider Trophy contest was held in April 1913 at Monte Carlo, on France's Mediterranean coast. Maurice Prévost won in a floatplane version of the Gordon Bennett Trophy-winning Depardieu du Sein, and this was in spite of breaking his tailplane during a practice flight. Australian Howard Pixton won the following year at a speed of 87 miles per hour, well below the land plane record. But a decade later, Schneider aircraft would become the leading speed record breakers. Improving aircraft designs led to the development of aerobatics. Aviators learned to cope with spins and stalls, and soon crowds at air shows were being thrilled by daredevil stunts performed by professional aerobatic pilots. In 1913, aircraft began to loop the loop, and this became the ambition of every aspiring pilot. Women, too, were becoming keen on flying, although not without some opposition from their male counterparts, who tried to prevent them from gaining pilots' licenses. But women pilots proved to be a determined breed. Their flying costumes also added elegance to aviation. The Zeppelin airships continued to make a successful business out of flying passengers, with the Count himself proving to be an excellent salesman. Inevitably, experiments were begun to use heavier-than-air machines in the same way. It was a young Russian, Igor Sikorsky, who designed the first true airliners. Indeed, he also produced the world's first four-engined aircraft. His massive Ilya Mauromets carried up to 12 passengers on a round trip of nearly 1,600 miles between Kiev and St. Petersburg in July 1914. However, the first airline using aircraft, as opposed to airships, had already been started in America between St. Petersburg and Tampa, a distance of 19 miles. This was inaugurated on New Year's Day 1914 and used a Benoist flying boat. Unable to pay its way, it went out of business after 3 months. By 1914, all of the world's major armies and navies were employing aviation. Heavier-than-air machines were being used for reconnaissance, although some questioned their value in this role. Airships like this French model enabled fleets to observe far beyond the horizon. There was also talk of them being used as bombers. Land planes had, however, already been in combat. This was in present-day Libya, where the Italians fought a war with Turkey during 1911-12. Indeed, it was a Captain Piazza who flew the first combat mission ever in his Blériot monoplane. He carried out a reconnaissance of the Turkish lines on the 22nd of October, 1911. By 1914, aviation in all its forms had begun to establish both civilian and military roles. The Great War would confirm its importance as a military weapon, but much more pioneering work and trailblazing would be needed before commercial aviation assumed a shape that we would recognize today. Indeed, the years leading up to 1914 had merely been the dawn of powered flight. Today, at Kitty Hawk, North Carolina, there stands a memorial to the epic first powered aircraft flight on that blustery December day in 1903. Orville and Wilbur Wright had achieved aviation's greatest milestone and initiated one of the most thrilling chapters in the history of flight. Subsequent chapters in the story would contain their fair share of achievement and excitement. But none can quite match the magic of that first decade of powered flight, when daring young men and women staggered off the ground on a wing and a prayer to challenge the elements above.